Hi there. Today I'm going to do a quick review and teardown of the Scofix programmable digital water timer you see here on their website. It's on offer right now and at £14 quite a bargain, if it is any good. In the past I had several water timers, none of them very successful. Most failed due to water ingress from rain or possible internal leaks, and they were a nightmare to use, such as having to wait for the time of watering to activate the timer since it had no internal clock, just an interval timer. Let's see if this one's any better. I picked it up from my local Scofix outlet in this rather plain box, which I don't mind at all. Inside is the adapter to connect to standard hose couplings, instructions, and the timer unit itself, which is rather large with a big LCD and a couple of buttons on the front. It is made of plastic with some rubbery side panels, but overall it feels quite solid and well made. The instruction is a single sheet of paper, slightly smaller than A4 and all in English, which is a welcome surprise. The rear is all blank. The quality of the text and graphics is good and easy to understand. The battery compartment is on the rear in form of this little tray that holds two AA batteries, and the instruction says to use alkaline cells. You can just see a bit of the circuit board through the opening of the battery tray. To see more of what's inside, I'm going to open the four screws at the back. And we're in, or rather, everything seems to be falling out. Oh dear, not the most promising start. Are the wires to that big solenoid just connected with these untidy bits of black insulation tape? This big solenoid worries me in terms of power consumption. Does this need to be continuously powered to allow water to flow, or does it latch open or close and only need power to be moved from one to the other? The electronics part is actually in another compartment, which has been sealed with this white compound. There appears to be some latches to hold the inside in place, but without destroying the sealant here, there is no way to get further into the unit, and since I'm going to put this out in the garden for a long-term test, I'm not going to use force here. I like the way they waterproof the inside, and some thought seems to have been spent on the battery tray as well. It has a rubbery seal, and it goes in at an upwards angle, so water can't get into the electronics that way. The battery box has just two contact pads on the rear. When slid in, two springy metal contacts sticking out from the PCB make the contact. The drawback is that these contacts are impossible to reach, so it will be tricky to measure the unit's power consumption. Here's my solution. Two cardboard strips, sized and folded to represent AA batteries, hold two thin wires against the contacts. The wires are thin enough to let the tray close and make contact with the PCB. My test setup has the unit powered from a power supply set to 3 volts, and the current measured by a bench multimeter and recorded on a PC using the GPIB to USB interface. At power on, like after replacing batteries, the unit goes through a self-test and there are quite some power spikes. The time entry blinks for a while to prompt you entering the correct time. I will go about the settings later. Right now, all I want is to turn the unit on and off to measure the current on the solenoid. Using the down button, you can move the cursor down from the top line named Time to the last line called Program. The selected entry blinks. Once at Program, you use the right button to select Manual and press OK. You can set the duration, which is 1 minute in this case, and skip the rest. The unit turns on and shows a nice animated graphic on the LCD. There's some more current spikes a few seconds later. 1 minute later, the unit turns off with some more spikes. Here's the recording of the measurement. The current is on the vertical axis and the time on the horizontal. We see 3 distinct groups of current spikes. At the 17 second mark, I turned the unit on, and a few seconds later, a number of larger and smaller power spikes happened as the unit went through its boot up procedure. Then it settled to almost zero at this scale while I used the keypad to manually select the on mode. When I pressed OK about the 60 second mark, the unit went through 2 large spikes, turning the solenoid on. Since the manual mode was 1 minute, another set of spikes happened at the 120 second mark when the unit turned the solenoid off again. What is obvious that the unit does not consume extra current while the solenoid is open or closed, only when it changes. This means it uses so-called bistable solenoid valves, where the valve is opened by a positive electrical pulse and closed by a negative pulse, and in between the valve is held in either state by permanent magnets without needing power. Since this is a graph of the battery current, not the solenoid current, positive or negative pulses will always show as positive pulses for the battery. Interestingly, this unit uses 2 pulses, a few seconds apart, for each opening and closing. I can only imagine that they do that to make sure it goes where it should. Likewise, I assume that they send 2 closing pulses during the boot up to make sure the unit starts with a closed valve. The current, when the solenoid is not activated, is just 0.03 milliamps or 30 microamps. This is good news and means the batteries should last quite long, depending on how low the voltage can drop with the unit still working. I have hooked up a multimeter reading the supply voltage and gradually reduce it. This needs to be done slowly because the processor in this unit will check the battery voltage probably not all that frequently. After all, battery voltage normally doesn't drop in seconds. I'm showing this in time lapse. You can see the elapsed time on the display of the water timer. I try to leave about 1 minute between every drop of 100 millivolt in the supply voltage. At 2.5 volts, we get the low battery voltage symbol and the normal display disappears. I like that because it makes the low battery condition hard to miss. Because I use 100 millivolt decrements, 2.5 volts is only a rough indication, but now that we know that value, we can refine it somewhat. This is a completely new run after reset, and I left the unit operating at 2.6 volts for 8 minutes just to be sure that 2.6 volts is still above the low bat threshold. I now reduce it to 2.56 volts. Four minutes later and the unit is still going okay, so 2.56 volts is still above the threshold. I'm now reducing it to 2.53 volts. And we get a low battery. Here's a data sheet of a typical alkaline AA battery cell. Other brands are of course available. The diagram we are interested in is on the lower left. This is the diagram enlarged to make it easier to read. If we assume a safe minimum voltage of 2.56 volts, it means that each of the 2 battery cells will have discharged to 1.28 volts. The lowest current shown in this diagram is 5 milliamps, and for just under 1.3 volts, the service hour is about 360 hours or 15 days. In our case, however, the normal discharge current, that is, if the valve isn't switched on, is only 0.03 milliamps, which is more than 150 times lower than the 5 milliamps in this diagram. Based on this consumption alone, the batteries will last years. Of course, that's not the whole truth either. Every time you do a cycle, that is, turn the water on and then off again, the unit will draw 4 bursts of very high current, 500 milliamps or so, but only for a second each. Because of these bursts and because of the relatively high threshold for the low battery indicator, the truth will be somewhere in the middle, way longer than 15 days, but not nearly 2 years either. I would estimate that with one cycle per day, it should operate at least for half a year with a reasonable good set of batteries. Incidentally, I assume that the high threshold of the low battery indicator is to ensure that the batteries still hold enough current to turn the valve off. If it wasn't for that, the 1.28 volts threshold would be a pretty bad design, considering that microcontrollers with LCD screens can nowadays easily operate down to 1 volt or less than 1 volt per battery cell. Let me quickly go over the setup of the unit. Setting time and day of the week is easy using the plus minus buttons. Keeping them pressed increments or decrements faster. An interesting quirk is changing from the default 12-hour mode to 24-hour. This is done by pressing the OK button for 10 seconds. But what the unit actually does is not just the time format, it actually resets as well. And you lose all your cycles and watering days if you had any setup. So if you like your display in 24 hours format, do this first before setting up anything else. Next, the water days. The idea is that if you enable a water drop under a day of the week, the unit will perform watering cycles on that day. If there isn't a water drop, then no watering will be done on that day. You can set your own pattern or use the second field to set up watering every second day or third for every third. Very handy, but since it works with the constraints of the 7 water days, Sunday to Saturday, there will be watering days following each other immediately. For me, that's not too much of an issue. On to watering cycles. On each water day, you can have 1 to 4 cycles of watering. The cycles are the same for all water days. For each cycle, you select the start time using the plus minus buttons. Say 6 in the morning, and then the duration in minutes up to 240. You can then set or skip the so-called eco function. This allows you to pause watering every few minutes to let the soil absorb the water and avoid runoff, for example, at a slope. Note that whatever eco settings you choose, it's the same for all cycles. If you set the eco to 0, water will flow as specified in the cycle time. Set the next cycle or cycles if needed. Cycles work if the program mode on the bottom is set to auto. I like that when running, the display always shows the cycle that will come next. If you have set overlapping cycles, if one cycle is completely within the other, it is ignored, otherwise the unit takes the earliest to begin watering and the latest to end. All in all, very sensible behavior. When I read the spec of the timer on the slightly incomplete website, I had the faint hope that the extra mentioning of a 6-day rain delay function would mean something smart, for example a rain sensor telling the unit not to water automatically. Sadly, this is not the case and apparently asking too much for that price. So what then is the fabled rain delay function? All it means, you can set the program mode to delay and type the number of days during which the unit does nothing. That is, it runs as normal internally but no watering occurs and it just shows a day countdown. Apparently the idea is that if you see a forecast or maybe it's already raining, In which case, you can estimate how long you don't need to water and then set the delay. You could of course also set the broker mode to off or turn the tap off, but then you will need to remember to turn it back on, so I guess it has its use. I have used the manual function already when measuring the current, so this is very straightforward. You select manual, then set the time for how long to water, and if you want the eco function. It appears you can't set to water forever. But you can stop any watering by selecting the off program mode and confirming with the OK button. As long as you leave it in off mode, no automatic watering will occur. Before putting the unit back together, I decided to get rid of that ugly tape insulating the connection to the solenoid coil. All reconnected and insulated with heat shrink tube, ready for reassembly. I wonder why they went through the effort to make those rubbery side panels, but anyway, the parts fit easy enough together and the solenoid assembly is held securely when the back shell is reattached. I connected the unit to an outdoor tap. Excuse the shaky video, I'm holding the camera with one hand and operating the buttons with the other. Oh, I forgot to press the OK on the manual program. It's quite splashy, so I better turn it off manually instead of waiting a minute. So what's the verdict? First, there are two slight niggles I want to point out that all appear once the unit is installed. The first is the display viewing angle, which is an issue with all LCDs. It is great when looking at it straight on or just slightly from above, but pretty bad when the unit is mounted on a tap somewhere at knee height and you are standing. The only way to be able to read the display is to bend down. The other niggle is that the buttons need to be pressed quite hard. This is probably because they operate through a rubber seal to prevent water ingress. But because the unit is hanging on its water inlet connection, which is on the far side from the keypad, you can't exert much pressure without stressing or twisting the water inlet. So the best but somewhat awkward way is to use your thumb to press the buttons while using the other fingers to steady the unit. Now to the good part. A lot of thought went into the construction to prevent water damage. The inner housing with the electronics is sealed and the battery tray angled upwards to prevent water from entering. The plastic material for the housing is quite thick. Time will tell if it gets brittle under sunlight. The tape insulating the connection to the coil isn't professional, but in fairness, probably good enough. Where this unit really shines is the ease in which it can be programmed and operated, especially when compared to most of the other water timers I have tried. It strikes a good balance between features and making operations overly complicated. The display is very clear and informative. The eco function isn't something I need because I use trickle watering, but if you connect a lawn sprinkler or have a steep slope, it can be very useful. In my opinion, that is more useful than the somewhat oversold rain delay function. The instructions are clear and well written, but as I said, once you played with the unit for a bit, you don't need them anyway, because it's all quite self-evident. Overall, I would definitely recommend this water timer. I have been using it now for a week and I will report in a few weeks how it held up. Thanks for watching.